When a study came out, it was a 7-year study done by Dr. Larry Clark, an MD, PhD from the University of Arizona School of Medicine. He took half of a group of 1,300 people, gave them 200 micrograms over 7 years, 200 micrograms of this trace mineral selenium every day for 7 years. And to make a long story short, at the end of the study, his final analysis showed that he slashed the occurrence, not the risk, but the actual occurrence of prostate cancer by 69%. Are there any drugs that will do that? Well, doing a prostate exam and taking your PSA, your prostate-specific antigen blood test every year, will that prevent prostate cancer by 69%? No. He reduced the actual occurrence of colorectal cancer by 64%. He reduced it by 75% by taking a multivitamin. He reduced the actual occurrence of lung cancer by 39%, whether you smoke or not. About 90% of lung cancer occurs in people who never smoked. Smoking is not the cause of lung cancer. It's inhaling all the fumes when you fry food is the biggest single cause of lung cancer. All those free radicals coming out of that margarine you're frying with. How could Ruth get lung cancer? She was a good church-going lady, never cussed, never even hung around smokers. How did she get lung cancer? But she was there early, every noon after church, frying food for everybody. Oh, the best part of the story is, 2 months after this result came out, Dr. Larry Clark died of prostate cancer at age 52. Now, why did that happen? Well, because he had set this study up to show that selenium didn't work. He hated selenium. He set the study up to prove that it wouldn't work, and he wouldn't take it. And the sick part about this is, he was a professor of medicine at the medical school at the University of Arizona, so he taught his beliefs to all the medical students there. And when he died of prostate cancer, they all said, oh, what a tragedy, and then went on avoiding selenium. They'll tell their patients not to take selenium. This came out March 6, 2002. Study says a diet rich in tomatoes can cut the risk of prostate cancer, raw tomatoes, by 24 to 36%. If you eat it, tomatoes cooked, one serving a day of cooked tomato will reduce your risk of prostate cancer by 52 to 60%. Because there's an antioxidant in tomatoes called lycopenes. Lycopenes. I love this when it came out in September of 1998. Call green tea the cure-all of cure-alls. Why is that important? Why do we have 85% more cancer than the Japanese? Well, our national drink is Coca-Cola. Their national drink is green tea. And green tea contains an antioxidant, catechins, or EGCGs, that are 100 times more potent than vitamin C in neutralizing free radicals. Catechins and EGCGs in green tea are 100 times more potent than vitamin C in neutralizing free radicals. And perhaps 100 times more potent than vitamin C in reducing your risk of cancer. Diabetes. An epidemic disease in the United States. There's a million new cases of diabetes every year. There's 32 million diabetics as we speak right now in America. 30 million of the 32 million diabetics are adult-onset type 2 diabetics. They make up the bulk of the diabetic population. And adult-onset type 2 diabetics make more insulin than non-diabetics. There's not an insulin problem with them. And usually if you're asking about insulin, say, well, I've got insulin. How can I be a diabetic? And so doctors say, well, you've got insulin-resistant diabetes. It's not working. The reason why it's not working is you're deficient in two trace minerals, chromium and vanadium, and their cofactors necessary for them to work, which are required by your insulin to work in your body. You can make tons of insulin, but if you don't have those trace minerals, your insulin's not going to work. We learned in 1957 that we could prevent and cure adult-onset type 2 diabetes in laboratory animals, pet animals, and farm animals by giving them these two trace minerals and their cofactors. This lay dormant for 20 years in human medicine, until 1977, when they found out that they could give intravenous chromium and vanadium and their cofactors to people who had diabetes, and they were unconscious from head injuries. They were in a coma. And they were miraculously cured by giving them intravenously these trace minerals and their cofactors. Now, you can't say that, oh, well, they just believed that they were going to get cured because they were going to get cured because they're in a coma. They didn't know what was going on. Now, how come your doctor doesn't tell you this stuff? I mean, it's been proven over and over and over in animals, been proven over and over and over in people. It's been published in every big medical journal in America and in the world. It sort of comes through every couple of years as renewed, you know, people look at it. It's not like it's a mystery. Every doctor knows this. Why don't doctors tell you this? Well, if a doctor took the less than 2 minutes that I just shared with you this information, he might get $80 for a long visit, an extended visit, instead of $50 for a standard visit. Make an extra $30. According to the GAO, the General Accounting Office, which is the budget watchdog for the U.S. Congress, your doctor makes, over the 25 to 40 years a diabetic lives after diagnosis, your doctor makes $750,000 for every diabetic patient. So why would he take $30 when he can make $750,000? And most people say, well, my doctor belongs to my church. I got to believe in him. Well, don't let that protect you. Even members of the mafia go to church, right? So I wouldn't bet on that one. According to the U.S. Department of Agriculture, 100 years ago, Americans were eating a half a pound of sugar per person per year. A half a pound of sugar per person per year. Today, 100 years later, according to the U.S. Department of Agriculture, Americans are eating 157 pounds of sugar per person per year, or now we're eating a half a pound a day. So in 100 years, we've gone from a half a pound of sugar per person per year to a half a pound of sugar per person per day. That, plus the deficiency of these nutrients in our food, has resulted in this epidemic of diabetes. Do you think our genetics has changed that much? I don't think so. If you look in the book Rare Earths Have Been Cures, one of our books, the guy who's doing all this study on these two trace minerals back in the 1950s, actually, Dr. Walter Mertz, went back into the 1940s and began to look at chromium levels in American blood, and he found out there was a big range in 1948, micrograms per liter, parts per billion, 28 to 1,000. In 1971, it dropped to 13. In 72, it dropped to 10. In 73, our chromium levels in our blood dropped to 4.7 to 5.1. In 74, it dropped to 0.73 to 1.6. In 78, it dropped to 0.16. Is it going up or down? It's dropping like a rock. Well, in 1980, it went up three times over 1978 values to 0.43. Why did that happen? Remember 1977? They're publishing all these papers on how chromium vanadium was good for you. And so everybody was taking chromium vanadium. They were running to health food stores and taking it. And so everybody's blood levels of chromium vanadium went up. But because they couldn't cure diabetes with chromium vanadium without all those other cofactors, in 1985 it went back down to 0.13 because people got frustrated because it wouldn't work if you just used those two trace minerals without the other cofactors. So between not having enough of these nutrients, the chromium and vanadium and their cofactors in our food anymore, and eating all this sugar, more sugar, less chromium, vanadium, we have an epidemic. We have an epidemic of adult onset type 2 diabetes. The last one we're going to talk about is arthritis and osteoporosis. Arthritis and osteoporosis. According to the Center for Disease Control, 85% of all Americans over the age of 50 already have arthritis and osteoporosis of one type or another, or to one degree or another. There's not a single medical treatment designed to prevent or fix it. Aspirin, Celebrex, Vioxx, Tylenol, ibuprofen, Advil, Aleve, methotrexate, gold shots, prednisone, cortisone. None of those prevent or cure osteoporosis and arthritis. They all have terrible side effects, many of which are life-threatening. And what makes this really, really, really bad, ladies and gentlemen, we learned how to prevent and cure osteoporosis and arthritis in animals over 300 years ago. Now, we didn't know all the biochemical reasons why these approaches worked, but we knew in the last 75 years the biochemical reasons why these little nutritional formulas worked. But we knew how to prevent and cure osteoporosis and arthritis in animals for over 300 years, in some societies, 1,000 years. And your doctor is still trying to just give you painkillers and doing surgery. How many of you heard of arthroscopic surgery of the knee for arthritis? Yeah, it's a very common procedure now. This came out in July of 2002. Arthroscopic knee surgery for arthritis is a worthless procedure. This was published in the New England Journal of Medicine. How many of you know somebody who's had arthroscopic surgery of the knee? Yeah, well, if you have arthroscopic surgery of the knee for arthritis, that doesn't deal with the systemic problem that's going on, right? Just one little knee. And, of course, doctors in 2001, and there's only like maybe 5,000 doctors out of the 1 million doctors who do this procedure, their income for that one procedure in 2001 was $1.5 billion. Now, do you think they'll ever give up that procedure? No, it's been proven to be worthless, published in the New England Journal of Medicine as a worthless procedure.